Ladies and gentlemen, we'll begin programming shortly, but please come in and take your seats. Thank you. We're about to start, so please.
Good morning. We are the Genki Spark. Now, we're going to tell you a little bit more about ourselves, but we are all about the energy in the room. I am well aware that it's just after 9 a.m., but we would like for you all to engage with us. So when we say Genki, we want you all to say Spark, okay? Genki!
Spark!
Genki!
Spark!
Oh my God, this gig is going to go so well, like artists playing for artists. I love it. I love it. So we have a lot of members. We've got 7 members in training and about 12 current members. But to my far left, we have Lisa. Next, we have the amazing Kumiko. And we have our member in training, Chen. And then we have Anne. And my name is Pyle, and we are so excited to be here. So I'm going to excuse my members now to go set up for the next piece while I tell you a little bit more about who we are, what we do, and how we rock. So the Genki Spark is a pan-Asian, multi-generational, all-women's arts and advocacy organization. And I want to point out and really highlight the multi-generational part of it, because our youngest member is 18 and our oldest member is 61. And we call her the grandma of our troop because she is a grandma. And we love the fact that like all of us can engage with art, and art isn't necessarily for all those who are just, you know, like super, super experienced. We really believe that anybody can play taiko, which is the Japanese word for drum. I have about 90 seconds remaining here to tell you a little bit more about who we are. We also play these wonderful drums, but also what we do is I highlight the narrative of Asian American women and make sure that this particular art form, this marginalized art form, has its space in all the different art scenes. One of the other things that we're about, particularly given what's been happening in the news and what we've been seeing, is I wanted to make a mention that we are all about empowerment and uplifting ourselves and making sure that we can bring all of ourselves and all of our identities to the table and be fully free. So the message we want to say is that art can heal, and that's what we're doing right now, and I'm hoping that that's what you all are doing during this conference right now. So we have one more song to play for you. I love the energy already, and I figure you can give me a little bit more. Our piece is called, yeah, I like that table over there. So we're going to play a song for you called Stepping Stones. We learned it from a group in the UK by a man named Oliver Kirby. Now, usually when we play the song, people clap along. If you decide you want to jump out of your chair or dance a little bit, I will not judge you. This is an open, wonderful space, and what a way to kick off today. So, without further ado, let's play some Stepping Stones. Stepping! Stepping!
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jessica Yaz from Ovation TV.
That was amazing. What an amazing performance. Let's give them one more round of applause for Genki Spark. Very cool. My name is Jessica Yaz. Good morning to all of you. I am the Director of Corporate Relations for Ovation TV and the Ovation Foundation. We put the bags on your chairs this morning, so of course. Small token of our appreciation for all of you. For those of you who might not know who Ovation is, we are an independent arts television network. And we are dedicated to celebrating and bringing to your homes, to your televisions, all forms of arts and culture. And the strength of our network really lays in the relationships that we have with you guys, because we are not owned by a larger conglomerate, we are independently owned, small board, and we don't have a lot of leverage or bargaining power when it comes to the big distribution media networks. And so we have an army of artists and art advocates in you that help us stay relevant and stay on the air. And we really appreciate that, so thank you for being supportive of Ovation and the arts. From the beginning, we've heard that arts networks aren't viable and that there isn't a thirst or a need for artistic representation on television. But we vehemently disagree with this, and we think that we are proving that wrong every single day. We have some amazing programming, and we will actually see a little bit of that programming right now on a reel that we have brought to show you. So, enjoy.
Everybody, please put a thumb in the air.
That has actually inspired me.
I feel like a million bucks, but my money don't really feel like I do.
All right.
Money, what I'm about, trying to get so much that I can't keep count.
New kicks give me cushion like whoopee. The only thing that matters is what you're creating. Get it when I'm wrecking the etiquette for the hell of it, smelling it when the hell is it. I'm flying in a pelican. Intelligent, cool. I'm acting like a gentleman.
I had a passion for music that was gonna be my power.
Tell your friends, say I can make some funny faces.
Me, yeah, I rock the beat.
It's not something that you get into, it's something that gets into you.
Perfection, superb, magnifique.
Making YouTube videos is what I want to do.
Oh, let's do this.
A little intense, but like way cool.
All season long, we're bringing some of the best authors, poets, songwriters, screenwriters, journalists for a lively conversation about writing and the writer's life. Come join the party.
I'm about to drag this country out of the darkness and into the light.
You are the king of our future.
He sees Versailles, nothing else. He's forgotten who built this country.
Power means everything.
One man cannot rule the land.
I am honored that His Majesty chose to see me last night.
There's a traitor in our midst.
Not even a king can stop a tide.
It's hard to be a king. Try being a king's brother for a day.
Bow to your king.
Art is part of our lives. It's not relegated behind velvet ropes and old buildings. Art is the soda bottle we drink from, the cars we drive, the music we listen to. Art is everywhere. Ovation is always on the lookout for bold and exciting new trends. We want artists to flourish and to succeed in today's creative marketplace. The creative economy is thriving, generating $698 billion annually. And as a result, the demand for artists has never been stronger. Our goal at the Ovation Foundation is to build up the arts community, to support them, and to see them grow. We've partnered with arts organizations across the country, donating over $15 million in grants and media. Coming this fall, the Innovation Grant Awards focus on the creative economy and nonprofits that build up the creative industries, specializing in training programs, mentorships, and entrepreneurial incubators. We're dedicated to providing opportunities for the next generation of artists while empowering today's creators with the tools and skills that they need to excel. Please visit theovationfoundation.org to learn more about how you can qualify for this year's grant.
Thank you. So we need your help in getting the word out about not only our programming, but our grants that we have coming up this fall. I would love to see, it's a nationwide grant, and I want to see applications from every corner of the country. So we hope you can help us in getting the word out. Once again, thank you so much for your passion for the arts. We appreciate each and every one of you and all the work that you do. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jim Canales. He is the president of the Bar Foundation and our moderator and guide through today's plenary session. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. And let me add to the chorus of welcomes that you've undoubtedly received. Welcome to Boston. We are thrilled to have you here. We ordered some great weather for you, as you can tell, but hopefully not so great that it's going to tempt you to be leaving sessions like these, which we know are just going to be terrific. I have the privilege of leading us through what's going to be a three-part plenary session this morning that's really focused on exploring the role of the arts in fostering vibrant, healthy, and equitable communities. And so let me take a moment to orient you to the flow of the day. We're going to start this morning hearing from Donna Brazile, whom many of us know if we are avid watchers of CNN and have seen her in multiple other settings as well. And we are looking forward to hearing her thoughts about the role of the arts in politics. After her remarks, we'll have a few minutes for Q&A, so I would just note that, and we have microphones in the audience for all of you. Then in part two of our plenary, we're going to have the opportunity to hear from NEA Chairman Jane Chu. And after Jane's remarks, which are really going to be focused on the intersection of the arts with other disciplines, as well as with other non-arts organizations, we'll have an opportunity to be in dialogue with Jane and with the President and CEO of Americans for the Arts, Bob Lynch. And then finally, in part three of our plenary, we're going to have the opportunity to engage with three visionary artists: violinist Vijay Gupta, artist Ana Teresa Fernandez, and performer Jay Fajeda. Our goal this morning is really to have an opportunity to have all of us hear from leading voices on this question of the role of the arts in fostering equitable, healthy, and vibrant communities. We hope as we do so, we want to bring the artist perspective into the conversation, which is why we've invited three outstanding artists to join us. And then finally, as you'll see throughout the morning, in an effort to keep it lively and engaging for all of you, we're also going to have an opportunity to experience great art, as we just did at the beginning of the session. So it promises to be a really terrific and engaging morning, and we thank you for being with us today. I'm now going to take a moment to introduce Donna Brazile. As many of you know, Donna Brazile is a veteran Democratic strategist, political commentator, and prolific writer around issues of politics. But in addition to that, she really has a passion around civic engagement. It's a passion that began at age 9 when she decided to support a city council candidate who was going to advocate for a playground in her neighborhood. So that very much planted the seeds of what we have seen today. But Donna, in addition to all the things that she does that we are aware of, has a secret passion, and that is that she has said that acting will be her third act. And if many of you watch The Good Wife, you may have seen that she's actually had a number of parts on that series. Donna is also a vice chair of the Democratic National Committee, and she was also really the first African-American woman to lead a major presidential campaign. So we're delighted to have her with us. Please join me in welcoming Donna Brazile.
If so, we know we'll be coming. If so, we know we'll be coming.
Well, wow. Good morning. I'm still reacting to the drums. I mean, if I had that every morning before I went on ABC with George Stephanopoulos, can you imagine how much music we would make, the harmony we will, you know, put in place and the rhythm that will go throughout the nation? It would have a ripple effect on our attitudes, and of course, there would be joy, joy, joy. Well, thanks so much for allowing me to be part of this conference again. I was with you several years ago in Philadelphia. All you Philly folks, get ready for us. We're coming your way this in just a few weeks. And by the way, for those of you in Cleveland, some of us will also be coming your way. Wish us the best. I'll be hanging out at the Rock and Roll Museum as I guess my fellow Americans gather in the arena to hear Donald Trump. I'll be in the Rock and Roll Museum. Well, as you all know, and thank you, Jim, for your kind and gracious introduction, I have appeared on The Good Wife 3 times. House of Cards 2x, that's on Netflix. BET allowed me to play myself on Being Mary Jane. The only problem with playing myself, I have to resist the temptation to tell the director that's not what Donna would say. But after all these years in politics, I'm probably best suited for the Game of Thrones. I've handled just about everything but dragons, but who knows, this election is so disruptive. I am prepared to handle dragons by fall. It's good to be back in Boston. I've had 2 tours here in this wonderful, beautiful city. Yeah. The first tour didn't end up so well. That was a Dukakis campaign. Second time, I came up and spent a year at the Harvard Institute of Politics. That was good, although let me just remind you, it's nice to be here in the summer. Be careful of those winters. It was really cold that year. But Boston, like my beloved hometown of New Orleans, has a rich cultural heritage, a long history of supporting the arts, in all of its forms. That support, that encouragement, of course, continues today. From the street musicians performing jazz in New Orleans, and I have to tell you a story. I was performing, my mother would give us a quarter. Back then, a quarter was a lot of money. It's like a $20 from the ATM now. But for 10 cents, you can get on a streetcar, you get down to the quarter, and my brother Teddy Man and I, his name was Lionel Jr., but we called him Teddy Man because he was born with a potato-like head. And hey, guess what? You know, I had nicknames too, and I won't tell you because I prefer to be tweeted as the diva, not as what my brothers and sisters often called me. But Teddy Man and I used to go downtown, and when the tourists would come in, we would just dance and dance and sing, and you know, we would make maybe 55, 60 cents. It wasn't a lot of money back then, but for us, the ability to go and express ourselves, to be part of that vibrant culture, to be part of that wonderful groove that we call the French Quarter, it meant so much to us, so much to, for people who are native-born Louisianians. And that's why, after that horrible Hurricane Katrina, made landfall on the Gulf Coast and destroyed much of my beloved city, I went not only to my governor, but to President George W. Bush and said, I am here to serve. And after 10 years, I can tell you, Louisiana, New Orleans, the Gulf Coast is back, but more importantly, people are flocking to the French Quarters and the kids are dancing back in the streets. So thank you, America, for bringing back my beloved city. But we all know that art can change hearts. The arts can build character, allow us to express ourselves, to be who we really, truly are. And there's a reason to be optimistic. I know This is a very tough time for many of us. Those of us who care about our country, care about our planet, this is a very tough time. This is why we've been called, I believe, into action. The current political climate, and I must tell you, I've been involved in politics since the age of 9, 40 years total, 55 congressional campaigns, 7 presidential campaigns, 19 state and local campaigns. And let me just tell you, I've worked in 49 states. One more state, I'm going to become Miss USA without the bikini. But this current political climate, and we've seen it over the years, I'm going to be very honest today. I'm not coming here as a Democratic strategist, though I am. I'm not coming here as someone who is advocating for a certain political candidate. Of course, I do believe that she will become the next president of the United States. And look, I feel the burn too. However, a woman of a certain age can't get so hot. I told that to Bernie, I said, Bernie, man, you can burn me up, but baby, guess what? I can't sizzle anymore. I sizzle all the time. But we have politicians today that truly don't really believe in the arts. They're not funding education. They're not funding arts education. They have this so-called false equivalence of what we must demand from the marketplace, what we must demand from educators. And we have to begin to raise our voices. That's why it's important that wherever we are, wherever we stand, wherever we may land, we have to speak up. You know, last Sunday, I knew my talking points. Of course, everybody sends me talking points. I love when they send me talking points. Dearly beloved, really? I'm not going there. I mean, last week, here on national TV, on network television, they were afraid to say it was a gay club. I said, hell, it was a gay club, and this is Pride Month. Say it. And while we're at it, we shouldn't forget their names. We shouldn't forget, and I wrote them down because I don't want to forget their names. So every time they say, we have to talk about the left or the right or this one, and I said, no, we have to talk about Geraldo, Frankie, 1L, 1C, Armando, Martin, Chris, Mercedes, Xavier, Gilberto, Oscar, Simon, Enrique, Miguel, Javier, Jason, Corey, Juan P, Jonathan, Christopher, Frank, Shane, Brenda, Angel, Paul, Antonio, Christopher, Alejandro, Rodolfo, Tevin, Yamara, Joel, Juan F, Harrell, Leroy, Jean, Ankra, Anthony, Dianca, Daryl, Eddie, Kimberly, Luis, Louis, Luis, Eric, Juan, Stanley, Edward. There are their names. That's who they are. We honor their memory. We honor their soul. We ask God to never allow us to forget them. Thank God. So I've been asked to discuss the impact of the political situation on the arts. I'm going to do that, and then Jim is going to question me as if he's Anderson Cooper, my boo. We would do well to remember that the arts have always had an impact on the political situation. Art affects politics at least as much as politics affects the arts. The impact of the arts on society, on systems of government, on communities, on how we organize and identify as a people, this impact is not always explicit, but it is always there, and it is considerable. Toni Morrison once said, and I quote, all good art is political. Art has to be both beautiful and political at the same time. Current political reality lends itself to the arts. It's chock full of comedy and tragedy. and sometimes they're impossible to tell apart. The current political situation isn't very admirable as politics, but as art, well, this election year is a work of genius. Never in my imagination could anyone have told me, and I have been involved. You probably will never meet someone who's been more engaged in the political process for the last 40 years at every level. And let me just say, I'm a superdelegate, get over it. I'm a member of the establishment, understand it. I helped to write the rules, at least on the Democratic side, and I know all of the Republican rules because we try not to follow their rules. So if there's a mess out here, I admit I might have created a little bit. But I'm working very hard to make sure that I clean it up and change it so that our politics is better, that our country is stronger, and our people will be able to exhale. I challenge you to name any great work of art that has inspired more laughter and tears in the current political situation. I'm serious. I mean, when grown men get up on national television, and by the way, is my hair okay? And as I never thought in my entire life, ladies, that I would be talking about a man's hand size. I'm like, keep it up here. I don't want to go down there. And then when you went there, there was nothing to see. Which is why we had to go there. It is void of substance. It is void of substance. I can't remember the last time I had to actually study before a show. When I first went on television, I knew all of the legislation. Ask me about the Affordable Care Act. I'll tell you it was 2,432 pages, and there were no pictures. I can tell you, I was on TV one day saying Section 1401 of the Affordable Care Act. I said, oh, Donna, why are you going there? Nobody cares about that. They want to talk about death panels. But there's no death panels in the law. And then, of course, they want to talk about abortion or birth control, and there's no abortion in the law. There's no there. Politics as a work of art has become a tragedy and a comedy. This is what we have become. You ask yourself why. You know why. Because most Americans are disengaged. They are not involved. Less than 5% of the American people have participated up to this point. Remember, we're a country of 320 million people. 5%. Ladies and gentlemen, we're in deep trouble. If we do not revive our democracy and our voices are not at the political table, because we essentially are going to devolve into a bigger tragedy. And so why you? Because there's no one better. You must become the advocates. You must become the fighter in the arena, and you must find your seat at the table, even if you have to bring in folding chairs. This election matters. And why now? Because tomorrow is not soon enough. If this presidential race was a work of art, we would be spilling ocean of ink asking, what is the artist trying to say? I guess in a sense we are. Of course, this presidential race would never have existed if it had to exist as a work of art. Think about that. What patron of the arts would fund such a disaster? Seriously. Who would fund what we're watching? The comedy, the tragedy of the 2016 presidential race. I wouldn't want to be the one writing a grant request for this mess. How will this election affect the arts? A Trump presidency could lead to an artistic awakening. I can't think of anything else that's more likely to make people question what life is really about. And when I say that, ladies and gentlemen, we live in a 50-50 country, so it is possible that we could end up with a Trump presidency. More and more Americans disengaged, not involved. My vote doesn't count. I constantly tell them, really? I can give you 537 ways why your votes matter. And I'm not a sore loser. Although, it did hurt to see the Supremes. I used to really believe in the Supremes until the Supreme Court decided that election. This election matters for the arts, for humanity, for our communities, and for every person in this society still struggling to get ahead, and for every child who's born into this world looking for a healthy start and a head start in life. In a Donald Trump presidency, I have to mention, he leads in a few polls this week. In his presidency, people would flock to the arts if only to avoid reality. It's true. I flock to the arts each week to avoid the reality. And let me tell you, you know what it's like to be a pundit during these days? You don't know what to say. Like I said, we're going places. I had to talk about a woman's look. I had to talk about a certain time of the month. And I'm like, really? What did he mean by blood flowing? I said, you know what? Can I have my pause and not have this conversation? We would flock to the arts to avoid to the reality. That's why we have to become more engaged, speak up, pay attention, be stronger advocates. Use all of the social media tools that my quote-unquote ex-boss developed when he inspired the invention of the internet. And ladies and gentlemen, I was there. I can attest to the fact that he inspired something. I have never owned so many gadgets in my life, and to this day, I get all of the gadgets ahead of time, if only because my boss inspired the beginning. My purse is there. Just lift it. You'll see. I got one of each in my purse because I'm testing for the next generation of whatever. And it all works. I even have a stylus in my purse. I've been testing that this morning. I drew something, then I colored it. It's a work of art. It's virtual. I can save it, but I don't know how to distribute it. But it's coming. And I thank you in advance for buying it. Now, I'm gonna say a couple other things. You standing up, Jim? You trying to tell me my time? I thought I had unlimited time. I'm on cable. Okay. When a man stands, a woman must stand even longer and stronger. Jim, I have a 20-page double-spaced 14-font speech. I'm on page 4. But I'm going to make sure I give it to you all. Y'all can put it online. But let me finish at least one or two more, because I write this myself. You know, I don't have one of them staff people that write for me. I'm trying to find somebody who can speak my language. But it's hard to speak from the heart and the soul when you have passion all, you know, when it's like jelly fresh, you know? This stuff you can't spread unless you have joy. When you wake up with joy, you share joy. When you wake up with passion, you share passion. And that's who I am this morning, because I had your coffee, baby. I had your coffee. I got 4 points and I'm gonna sit down, Jim. I'm gonna talk like a Baptist preacher. I'm gonna start low, go slow, rise high, strike fire, and sit my little ass down. But I'm really a Catholic girl, because I'm gonna sit around and wait, because at some point the Pope gonna finally say, I had enough of these men. I'm going to go out there and get the women to take over the church. I'm sticking around in the Catholic Church. Ladies and gentlemen, we need new artists to raise our awareness, to strike our conscience, and to rouse us into action. This is that year. This is the moment when there's a void, you go and fill it. When you see a blank canvas, you go and you begin to create what world, what kind of world we want to see. In 2008, when we elected our first black president, we broke the mold. Now we can actually develop and harnessed and inspired new leadership everywhere in this country. And we don't have to pick politicians anymore from those who are just in the political process. We can pick you. You're the ones who should be at the city council meeting. You're the ones who should be appearing before the state legislature. You're the ones who should be appearing before Congress. You're the ones who should demand that we fund the arts, and that we respect the arts, and that we lift up and inspire people through the arts. That's your voice, that's who you are, that's your passion, that's your calling, so it's your turn. Yeah. Even in an election that is worrying, as this one is, artists must have the courage to carry us all forward. We need you now more than ever to create that song, to do the dance, to have that work of art, to be the change that we constantly believe exists in this world, and we have to lead from a perspective that every individual matters, and we have to respect everyone. We need artists who will provoke us. We need artists who will stoke us. We need artists who will inspire us. As Toni Morrison said, we need to be more involved and engaged and have the intensity to carry forth our ideas. So this is that moment, and this is our time. And as I mentioned, why you? Because there's no one better. And why now? Because tomorrow is not soon enough. Sorry to say that Jim wants to question me. He's been up all night thinking of all of the big questions. He's been waiting for this moment all his adult life to be with a diva, to sit next to a woman who radiate heat, to feel my pulse, and to stoke my genius. So, Jim, come on up. It's Father's Day. Let's have it, baby. Thank you. Thank you.
Great.
All right, I got more work.
We'll take more. We'll take how they can.
Now, what am I going to do with all of this, Jim? I mean, I really got down in this writing. I'm so proud of myself. You know, I got a little dog. His name is Chippity Chippity Gumdrop. I'm going home and say, Chip, we need to have more visibility of artists. Can you imagine my little dog going to look at me and he's like, really? The irony, Chip, is that the public don't recognize how important this is. This is a good investment, Chip. And Chip going to say, Here's my leash. Let's go walking. All right.
Well, Donna, here's what I would say. I think there are many people in this room who know me and would appreciate the irony of your final comments about the radiation of heat and all of that.
Babe, I got more than you can stomach.
I'm sure. I've no doubt about that.
You put an egg on top of this, it will be scrambled.
No doubt.
You put bacon between this, it will be fried.
The other thing I will say is it is true that I have been waiting my entire life for this moment. And in fact, next year I turn 50, and I have to say, or later this year I turn 50, and I have to say that I've just started wearing reading glasses in the last couple of years, and obviously it's a sign of age. But now, after Donna sort of thought of me as Anderson Cooper, her boo, I figured that now I can wear these with a sense of pride.
Yay!
And I will have a very different
Yay!
Sort of way of thinking about all of this.
Oh, that's good, baby. You can do that all night. Yeah.
Donna, let's...
put that down.
Let's start with this. You've really, I think, in such an articulate way, pointed to the urgency of this moment. But I think that one of the tremendous challenges that all of us in this room face working in this field is we can all talk about the importance of the arts and its vitality and et cetera, et cetera. We all know what the lines are. But the reality is we live in a country where the dominant narrative is that the arts are viewed as something that's discretionary, that's a nice to have, that's something that's kind of great that you can do on the side, but they're not viewed in the fundamental way that they should be. And in fact, in Washington, so much of the dialogue about the challenges that we face often revolve about things other than the arts. And I'm just wondering, how do you help us, not just to encourage us to get engaged, but how do you help us to shift that narrative? What should we do to change that dominant narrative?
Thank you. That was on page 15 of my speech.
Thank you.
I needed 2 hours. Takes a woman a little longer when she's on a runway by herself. We have to dramatically reshape this narrative. The narrative of the last 30 years is much like the trickle-down economics. And that is, for those, the only way to succeed in this country is for you to major in, of course, science, technology, engineering, and math. And the arts, somehow or another, I like STEAM versus STEM. I do believe that we need to put that A because we also need that as a society. Something has happened to our society. I'm not saying that we've become callous and we have stopped thinking about each other, stopped communicating, but politicians now are focused on the bottom line. And the bottom line is that we live in what I like to refer to as a manufactured budget crisis, where we can come up with monies to build a stadium, okay? I mean, think about all of the cities across the country where we've expanded the basketball arena for the NBA, we've expanded the football stadium for the NFL, but somehow or another the NEA, the National Endowment for the Arts, we haven't expanded that. Budgetary funding almost flat. And so we have to become strong advocates. We have to almost inject ourselves in this conversation and say, but this is a great investment. For every dollar we spend in the arts, you know, it's a multiplying effect. $700 billion total in revenues, probably more. And that's huge, as Donald Trump would say. And so I do believe that we have to change the dialogue. We have to talk about how important the arts. I mean, every year, whether it's the Tony Awards, the Oscars, we never have a conversation around the arts. But somehow or another, in Seattle, when a city councilwoman voted to restrict public funding for a stadium, she was ostracized. But when you look at Cleveland, when a city council person expressed herself to get additional funding for the arts, she was applauded. So we have to find ways to not just build the constituency, but have a narrative that we can inject into these so-called manufactured budgetary crisis. And we also have to go to school board meetings. We just can't go to the legislature. We got to go to school boards. We have to be engaged at the local level, because if we're not, it has an effect of rippling down to our state and local governments that this doesn't matter. And art today is an extracurricular activity. So I have 19 nieces and nephews, and I'm a native Louisianian. And I have several of them who are musicians. I have several of them who are, you know, in the theater as well. And I can tell you that, you know, listening to my brothers and sisters, all of the activities that we did when I was a youth, It was part of the, quote unquote, the 9 to 4 or the 8 to 5. Now it's extracurricular. It's an additional expense. And we have to change that paradigm. It's really hurting our communities, hurting our children, for God's sake. But we live in a city, we live in a country now where everything is done under the notion of a crisis. And we have to somehow or another inject in the public debate that this is about life. This is about inspiring creativity. And this needs to be part of the funding, not an afterthought, but part of the overall experience of our young people, but also the overall mission of our society. It has to be part of our core values.
For those of you who are daring enough, there are two microphones over there for any questions. So I would invite you to please come up to those microphones. We're gonna have a few minutes for some questions of Donna. But Donna, I wanna pick up on your point about crisis and just turn very serious for a moment and say that your reading of those names up here was perhaps one of the more powerful moments that I've ever experienced in a plenary session. I could hear sobs where I was sitting, and it was just such a powerful reminder that this is not about a political issue, this is about people. And while this may not seem directly related to the arts, although I think the arts can play a role in this, I'm wondering what you would share with us about whether this is a different moment. What happened in Orlando offers a different kind of opportunity to get at this challenge that has been before us for so very long.
I know the political marketplace, and I can tell you after going to Newtown, I've had some amazing moments on television, and last weekend was just that moment when I felt like how many more people have to die? I mean, this is amazing that we're still having a conversation about removing assault weapons from the hands of people who should not possess them. And last week, after the senseless, horrific murder of 49 individuals, I went home and I said, okay, we're gonna have the same conversation that we had after Newtown, after Aurora, after Lafayette. I mean, I can name all of the places. After Charleston, 9 people gunned down in church. They invited him in. They gave him a seat, and he killed them. The President of the United States has appeared before us 16 times. I know personally, his heart hurts. Will it change the debate? We're gonna have 3 votes this week coming up. No, it will not change the debate. Unfortunately, the debate has been hijacked from reality. And somehow or another, given someone who has been listed on a quote unquote terrorist watch list, and I'm not all about that either, sometimes we get it wrong and we need to acknowledge that. But if you're on the watch list and you can't fly, you should not be able to buy. And when a gun owner notices something suspicious but cannot contact the FBI, or the FBI cannot, because of the law, the FBI cannot tell the gun owner, well, his name is on a list. There's something wrong. And if we, as Americans, this is common sense to have a background check. And yet, for some reason, there are lawmakers who are beholden to one interest group, one. And ladies and gentlemen, this has nothing to do with the Second Amendment. That's a lie, and you just got to say that. It has everything to do with politics. And we have to, when the murder, the senseless murder of those children in Newtown, and it happened on a Friday, I know, because my birthday is the 15th of December. And I was on my, that Sunday I was on this week, and they're like, well, we got to do the show in Newtown. I'm like, no. See, I'm one of them bleeding heart kind of liberals. I can't even hide my, I can't fake it. I love people, I love children, I love my country, I love I love. Love is so powerful. I will never allow hate even to even come near my door, let alone take a seat in my heart. Hell no. I learned this from my grandmother who, when Dr. King was murdered, some of you might be old enough to know that evening when we heard that Dr. King was dead. And here my grandmother, a daughter of slaves, she called us in the room and ordered our birth, Cheryl, Sheila, Donna, Tated, Chet, Lisa, Demetri, Kevin, Ziola. I told you we were Catholic. And she made us get on our knees and pray. She said, we gotta pray for Dr. King and his family, you know, our Father who art in heaven, you know, we little Catholic children. I'll be thy name, thy kingdom come, looking up like, is anybody gonna come and get us? When we finished doing that, Grandma said, and now we're gonna pray for whoever did this, because we have to pray for them too. That was from the book of Matthew, so you pray for your enemies. And we're looking at her, we're kids, I'm eight. I'm like, what? No, we will not hate. I learned that at 8 years old, we will not hate. There's too much hatred. We gotta get rid of this. When they start shooting your kids in school, when they shoot your family in the church, when you can't even go out at night and go and dance the night away, when you can't party, when you can't pray, when you can't learn because some person with a gun that he or she should not possess, although majority of men, there's something wrong when you can't even have a conversation or a debate in Congress to remove these assault, military style assault weapons from our streets. It's a danger to us all. And it's not about the Second Amendment, folks. It's about creating a society where love and peace and happiness is also part of our culture and our fabric.
Well, Donna, let me note that because of time, unfortunately, we're not going to have time for questions, but let me just...
I got this young man, baby, stand up. Come on.
I know, but I've got somebody right here who is going to really...
1 minute. Mara, come on now. You know this man here. This might be interesting.
Mara, you... Come, Mara, whatever you say.
Come on, Mara says Mara. Yes. This might be interesting. Come on, where you from?
Donna, thank you. My name is John Schratweiser. I'm the director of Maryland Citizens for the Arts, and I live in Baltimore. I think that, and I would like to pose to you, one of the challenges we face is that we are living in a time of an epidemic of short-term decisions, and that our political decisions are based on election cycles, and that very few people, with the exception of our current president, have the vision to think about making a decision that may not bear fruit during their current time in office. What can we, as artists who I think are nothing but long-term thinkers, do to change that conversation?
Throughout this year, I noticed on the campaign trail, because I'm out there, I saw ordinary citizens pose questions to all of the candidates. Hillary had the answer, Donald Trump and all the other political candidates out there. Hillary has a really strong, I believe, I've read both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump's, you know, they both filled out questionnaires. Read it. Understand their vision. We should do this not just at the presidential level, we should do it at all levels. When someone is running for city council, school board, state lawmakers, governors, we should know their views. Because often we can get a glimpse into the future, their vision, by knowing where they stand today. So I think that is one of the key tests as we move forward. We got to hold politicians accountable. More importantly, we got to remember that we pay them to lead us. Can you imagine that? We pay them to lead us. And when they fail to lead, we should remove them from office. Or as I often say, gently ask them to go home. But this is about our future, and we have to seize it. And this is about the future that we can create together. So I do believe that we have to begin to look at these candidates and see and witness what's in their minds, what do they believe the future should look like. And if we don't believe that we're included, don't put them in there. Let me close with this. My grandmother, I mentioned my grandmother, so when I invoked her spirit, she showed up. And so in her spirit, I have to tell you what she would tell us, the nine of us that she helped to raise. She would always quote from the Bible, which is why I love the Bible as well. It's a great work of art as well as history. And she would quote from the book of Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Do not grow weary in doing good, for in due season you'll reap a harvest if you don't give up. Think about all of the creativity, the passion, the inspiration from the arts. And that is our calling, to plant those seeds and to prepare the harvest for the future. So thank you for having me. I look forward to seeing you all again. Thank you so
Donna,
much.
Donna, thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll share this. I will share this. Thank you. Let me grab this piece of paper right quick. I have my names on there.
Go ahead.
Thank you, sir.
That was great.
Thank you. All right.
Wasn't that remarkable? That was violinist Vijay Gupta first doing a solo as he entered. And then playing the second piece accompanied to the mini documentary of Ana Teresa Fernandez's piece, Borrando la Frontera, or Erasing the Border. I'll introduce them more fully in a few minutes when we are joined by all three artists on stage for the third part of the plenary. But now on to part two, where it's my pleasure to welcome NEA Chairman Jane Chu. As many of you know, Jane Chu has been the chairman of the National Endowment for the Arts since June of 2014. She is the 11th chairman of the NEA, an accomplished advocate in philanthropy and accomplished arts administrator. She also has a deep background in the arts, as many of you may know. The child of Chinese immigrants, she grew up in Arkansas and received degrees in piano performance and music education, and brings all of those passions to bear in the work that she has done. In her two-year tenure, she has now visited some 88 different cities in close to 40 states across this country, and has made the ability to have her out in communities a hallmark of her tenure at the NEA. In fact, we were fortunate enough to welcome her here to Boston just about a year ago, where we took her around to a number of neighborhoods and organizations in the region. So it's my great pleasure now to welcome Jane Chu, chairman of the NEA, for some remarks.
Thank you, Jim, and thank you to everybody for being here today. As Jim mentioned, I have had the opportunity to visit communities across the country and see firsthand the way the arts are taking place. And people will often ask how one community compares with another. We know that we can look at communities from a lot of different perspectives. For example, how many people live in the community? Is it urban or rural? What types of businesses and economic activities take place in the community? Do residents mostly drive, or do they take some type of public transportation? What's the weather like? All of these perspectives tell us a lot of valuable information about a place, but if you really want to capture the essence of a community and its spirit and its energy, its vitality, then you look at the arts, because the arts can draw out and showcase the full potential of the places we call home. And every community has its own special character and its history and personality. The arts give us the tools to identify and celebrate these elements and transform challenges into assets. So for example, thanks to a collaboration between the city of Boston and Mass Poetry, artists have painted invisible poems on sidewalks, which only become visible when it rains. So just think, through the arts, having a rainy day has now become a reason to smile, and it's a testament to the creative spirit of this city. And the arts also have a way of bringing people together. Sometimes this is through sharing an experience as an audience. Sometimes it's by drawing people to a public space, maybe like a sculpture garden, a museum. Sometimes it's forming connections to benefit the greater community. For example, the Our Town program at the National Endowment for the Arts focuses on community vitality through the arts. And one of the key components of each project is that there's a partnership between arts organizations and various civic entities. And here in Boston, the Our Town project helped establish the first ever artist residency program in City Hall. Artists are embedded in local government offices for 6 months, and they introduce creative approaches to municipal services. And as a result, there have been strong collaborations that have formed, and the arts have been recognized as a critical tool for efficient and innovative government functions. So this project would not have happened, of course, without the vision of Mayor Marty Walsh, who created Boston's first cabinet-level position of Chief of Arts and Culture. The National Endowment for the Arts is really indebted to the work of leaders like Mayor Walsh, and we're so grateful for his continued dedication to the arts. So viewing our communities through an artistic lens has the potential to open up ways of doing things, new ways of engaging our citizens, new ways of appreciating the places we live and visit, because the arts can bring together diverse voices from every career and every corner, and they forge innovative new solutions to address community challenges. They engage people, and they engage people to notice and interact with the places they live. They install a sense of hometown pride. And we know that the arts are also a powerful and very important way to bring us together, all together, when we face the unimaginable, when we look at the heinous and inexcusable loss that took place in Orlando this week. The arts are about community, and they're about empathy and compassion, and they spark a spirit in us of life and thriving. Our thoughts and prayers are with all of the survivors of this unconscionable act and with the family and friends of those we lost. So we crave the beauty of the arts, and in so many ways, the arts stand alone as inspiration to us. But I also want to broaden the lens of the arts to touch other industries. How would the arts benefit different sectors? And in turn, how would that affect all of us? These were some of the questions the National Endowment for the Arts was mulling over when we launched the Creativity Connects initiative that integrates the arts with other non-art sectors. Creativity can help us solve complex or persistent problems in new ways, and it can synthesize perspectives and fields of study that may not appear to be related to each other at first. So we've seen firsthand how the arts can leverage other community assets, and we believe that creativity can build upon possibilities within fields as varied as healthcare and technology, commerce, transportation. So for instance, when design collaborates with healthcare, we see wheelchairs that put less strain on a nurse's back, and we see prosthetic limbs that are both functional and attractive, and we see hospital atmospheres that soothe and they comfort patients instead of frightening them with sterile environments. So when the arts are integrated with the military, we see creative therapies that help our service members recuperate from post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injury, and we see combat artists capture scenes of war for posterity, and sculptures and statues and paintings that commemorate our nation's bravest men and women. These are just a handful of benefits that have come from forging creative connections across industries, and with the Creativity Connects initiative, we want to provide fertile ground for even more collaborations between the arts and the non-arts sectors. So the Creativity Connects initiative has three components. The first component's a grant program that supports partnerships between arts organizations and other non-arts organizations. We'll announce this first round of Creativity Connects grants this fall. In the first round, we received more than 500 eligible Creativity Connects grant applications, and that's a lot of applications for a first-time pilot project. And what makes this figure so impressive is that the application window was just 3 months long. So the volume and the speed tells us that this type of integrative work that is already taking place across the nation. And so the National Endowment for the Arts is thrilled to be able to amplify this trend and this pattern and help strengthen creativity and those networks within the individual communities. And then the second component is going to feature the bright spots. So we're creating a web portal that visualizes how the arts connect to the United States creative ecosystem. So here you can learn about the bright spots, the successful projects across the country where arts and non-arts collaborators are working to further common goals. And users will be able to click on a non-arts sector and the arts sector associated with it and learn how the arts enhance creative efforts across our society. And so the web portal, the Bright Spots, will launch this fall. And then the third and final component is an infrastructure report. And this report, which the NEA is doing with the Center for Cultural Innovation, will give us a big picture overview of what artists need to succeed in these contemporary times, and we'll check to see if artistic practice is evolving. We think it is. We're already seeing it and hearing about it. And the report will also be released this fall. So it's going to look at the big trends and issues over the past decade, including issues of inequity, demographic changes, and the expansion of interdisciplinary work. So we're going to look at whether technology has changed how we produce art and connect with each other. It will make recommendations as to how the nation's arts infrastructure might need to change to adapt to current times. What does it take for an arts person to succeed nowadays? That's the main question. And we hope to answer that question and also spur a lot of richer conversations about how we can all step up to keep the creative life of this country thriving. We spent half a year gathering information for this report. We held 10 roundtables across the country with artists and arts administrators and educators, business people, individuals from all walks of life. And we had a lot of individual interviews and an online effort to collect information. And so over this period of time, we began to see that the collaborative opportunities that creativity can provide, especially at the roundtables, were really thriving. And people who had never met each other before even began to network and talk about how they might work together in the future. So the roundtables were so successful that we're now providing funds to all the state arts agencies and the regional arts organizations to host their own roundtables even further, because we're recognizing that cultural infrastructure differs region by region, state by state, community by community, and the roundtables, the further ones, will engage different voices, and they'll assist in the state and regional planning. It'll advance the national conversation at the local level. So already projects have happened that are an outgrowth of the Creativity Connects initiative. For example, Mid-America Arts Alliance has received a $500,000 grant from the Andrew Mellon Foundation, and this grant will support 6 arts projects, either visual or performing arts, where the arts organization partners with an organization in another zone of public life, such as business or education, environment, faith, finance, food, health, law, science, technology. And each project gets a $75,000 grant, and these will be demonstration projects. And we hope that these 6 new projects will allow the work to reach new audiences and produce replicable models that can inspire work across the country. And then in the fall, we're also going to continue our discovery and broaden the conversation on all that we have learned from the Creativity Connects initiative in a convening at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. on November 18th. And this convening will bring together the thinkers and the leaders from all kinds of different sectors and from all different parts of the country to engage in solution-oriented dialogue about issues that are integral to the future of the arts and creativity in America. So these are the people who might not typically have occasion to interact with each other, but who we believe have meaningful conversations and contributions to make to the field. So we hope that the convening will leave, the people who attend it will leave with new energy and inspiration, and that we will begin the process of activating conversations about creativity in their own communities, and they will continue this in their areas of study. So while Creativity Connects is a national initiative, it's also one that's intended to have local results that will touch Americans in meaningful ways every day, because the country and its communities were built on creativity and innovation, and we want this project and the conversation it sparks to allow it to reach greater heights. Well, thank you for letting me join you today, and I will turn to Jim, and let's have a conversation.
I'd like to also welcome Bob Lynch, President and CEO of Americans for the Arts, to join us on stage. Jane, thank you very much. I want to start with you, Jane, because even though you spoke a lot about Creativity Connects and this whole cross-disciplinary piece, which I know we want to talk with Bob about, I want to start with something I said in my introduction, which is you have now visited over 130 different communities across this country. Talk a little bit about why that aspect has been such an important part of your leadership. Why that local community sort of focus to your chairmanship?
Well, I think that we're creating the arts in America together, and we're shaping it. And once you've been to one community, you've seen one community, you've only seen one community, because everybody is different from each other, and that is a great thing. So there's no cultural minister in this in America telling somebody what art is or what it is not. We are shaping the arts in the communities together, and we know what the arts can do. So we get to celebrate not force-fitting everybody to be exactly alike, but the arts do that in such a great way. And communities are looking for ways to distinguish themselves and differentiate themselves just as they have different characteristics and different personalities. So to be able to go out there and see firsthand what's going on and also celebrate the different ways, that's been a key piece of traveling, getting to know what you're doing and honoring what you're doing.
Great. And Bob, this is a nice way to bring you into the conversation because you all at Americans for the Arts have launched an effort in the last couple of years called New Community Visions, which is really intended to also have you out in communities listening and learning and helping to have that really shape an agenda for the work going forward. So maybe talk a little bit about that effort. You're now almost 2 years into it, funded by NITE and the NEA, and would love to learn more about what have you discerned from that work and what are the implications for that?
Great. I'll start, though, by saying that in addition to all of the other wonderful work that Jane has done at the National Endowment for the Arts, those of you who are in the jam session last night saw her play the flute and add an added dimension to a very rich package of help. Yeah. And Vijay played with us, too. So.
Well, that was awesome.
Awesome.
We were fun. He was awesome.
So that's true. The New Community Visions Initiative is based on something that we did a half a century ago and then again 25 years ago, which is to come up with concepts and ideas and model approaches for how communities can deal with advancing the arts and having the arts in those communities. So 50 years ago, it was simply about getting the arts in community. Now, it is very similar to what Jane has been talking about. It's the arts and community partnering with the rest of community to advance both the arts and community. And so the New Community Visions Initiative itself was eight regional meetings in eight cities across the country. And it was both arts organizations and non-arts organizations, again, coming together and talking about arts and health collaboration, for example, arts and education collaboration, arts and the military, arts and is what we actually call it, arts and ... because there is advancing the arts, and then there is what the arts can do in partnership for a better town or ultimately a better nation. So that information was gathered there, and then it's bolstered. What we learned there is bolstered by surveys and about 200 other professional development things that we do in the course of the year that involves people in this room from all across America. And that input then allows us, we hope, to come up with tools, which is basically more research, more information, more training, more money to help these organizations do the job themselves.
As you each think about undertaking this work that connects arts to other disciplines, as you put it, sort of arts and, how do you think about that in a way that doesn't then move us too far into the place of arts just being instrumental and arts really becoming a mechanism to achieve solely other aims? How do we make sure that we assert the centrality of the arts in that kind of cross-disciplinary work?
Well, it takes, for me, the first thing that comes to my mind is it takes a mindset of both and. So it doesn't have to be either or. Many of us, I came to get my own training because I was just so taken by the beauty of the arts. I was taken by the purity and the ability to learn how to not only express myself, but there was something related to being authentic by being able to express myself through the arts. I don't ever want to lose that. But you can have your cake and eat it too when it comes to the arts. So it isn't a zero-sum game where somebody wins and the other person loses, or we do it this way and that means we don't do it that way. This is about expressing the beauty of the arts and being inspired by it, and also having its connections to all the different ways people are engaged with the arts, including other industries and other non-sector industries. And can you imagine what it would be like to have other sectors say, wait a minute, we cannot do without the arts? We are strong believers in the arts altogether, and we talk about it, and we communicate, and we can tell those effective stories, and we also measure it. But can you imagine what it's like also if other sectors say, wait a minute, we can't do without the arts, we need them at the table. They're actually showing us how to stand in the middle of ambiguity without shrinking back. They're showing us how to be a leader in complex times when there's different perspectives, and we can synthesize those. So that is how I come to thinking about no, it isn't either or, and it's will we swing this way or that way, and that means we lose the other way. We want to be able to be embracing the both and not everybody can do that, but we can. The arts can do that.
I would agree with all of that, and I would just add to it a couple of things I learned along the trail. I grew up here in Massachusetts, and the got to connect with early on tribal organizations in Massachusetts, the Algonquins, or the Lakota Sioux in my work, and other Native American organizations. And I learned along the way that most Native American cultures have no word for art. They don't even look at it as a separate thing. They see it as a part of everything else in community, and so art is in everything. And I think that art as a broad community value is exciting, and it doesn't take away from art in and of itself in those same tribal communities. So I look at it as inherent value, that's there. Instrumental, as you talked about, is great, but what I think of it as is transformative. Mm-hmm. The arts as an integrated tool being transformative to community and to all of these other issues in community. And now, on the instrumental piece, though, I would say I learned a big lesson here in Massachusetts as well. 35 years ago when I was working on the state arts advocacy organization here, we had a governor, a Democratic governor, conservative Governor King, who wrote that he was going to eliminate the budget for the Mass Council on the Arts. And we tried everything, arts, you know, inherent value arguments and so on. Transformative wasn't really talked about that much in those days. But what we finally found was the first economic impact study that had been done, you know, by our friends at the New England Foundation for the Arts, and we put that in front of the governor. The budget was $2.3 million. He had eliminated it. We sat there with Governor King. We showed him this, and he says, if this is true, I'm not going to eliminate it. I'm going to increase the budget. And I was hooked. $3.5 million is what it went up to. I was hooked on different ways of looking at this issue, this problem, for both inherent value and instrumental value and transformative.
Let's conclude with this question, which is, as you think about this work that you're each doing, fast forward 10 years, and give us sort of a picture of what success looks like. What success looks like in either of the efforts that you're engaged in? How will we know that we've gotten to that destination?
Well, I really think we have an opportunity here to have the arts be the leaders in the community. It is not just the beauty and having it be looked at as an ancillary piece. You are the leaders for the communities. In 10 years, we're already seeing, as you know, people are starting to recognize that the arts are a strategy for bringing community vitality together. They're a strategy for economic development, and that's cool because we know what the arts can do in terms of sparking that vitality. But you know how to stand in the middle of the complexity, and the leaders of yesterday seem to be those who understood, say, one subject matter very, very well, deeply, and knew everything about it. There's nothing wrong with that. But I think the leaders of tomorrow, and possibly today, are the ones who can take disparate pieces that don't seem like they match, they might be in totally different orbits, and synthesize them together. Well, the arts do that probably better than anybody. Just think about how an artist is given a blank canvas. Some people are giving a blank canvas, and because that's never been done before, they say, well, it's never been done before, I don't know what to do, and you can feel the fear. But you don't do that. You're given a blank canvas, and you start drooling. What else can I do? How can I create something out of nothing? Your resources may be abundant, or they may be scarce, but you will figure out what to do with what you're given. Those are the leaders we need for tomorrow, and in 10 years, you will be the leaders at the table in the community.
So 10 years from now, what I'm looking for is the same thing I was looking for 10 years ago. And that is basically in every single community in America, our vision statement is all the arts, all the people. We've come a long way. We have a fabulous group here. We have many more communities, though, that need to adopt that. And what we want in each community, what we've seen as the success model, is a combination of leadership, actual leadership in the arts, but leadership in the rest of the community, mayors and city councils and so on. Vision, the idea of some kind of a vision that comes through a vision project that we're working on, planning, actually putting it out for a long-term vision, execution, that's the training of leaders that are actually going to make things happen, and resources. And the idea of resources comes from government resources, private resources, earned resources. That mix takes leadership to make that happen. If that happens, I think we get to a point where we get the true value of the arts, the beauty of the arts actually there. And one last thing, the arts themselves, much broader definition of what we mean. For-profit, non-profit, individual artists, the self-taught, which we talked about last night, the whole gamut is the excitement and the richness of the tapestry of the American community, and that's my vision for the next 10 years.
I think that's terrific, and I would just say that in our work at the Barr Foundation, as we've been thinking about how to fashion our strategies going forward, I think we've landed on many of these same themes. How do you really think about blurring the boundaries, about expanding our definitions, about thinking about synthesis and the ways in which various elements can come together? And at the end of the day, as the cultural plan that we launched here in Boston yesterday demonstrates, it's really about how do we have the arts at the table in a deeply authentic way. And I think those are themes that you both hit on. And I want to express my appreciation on behalf of all of us to Jane Chu and to Bob Lynch for being with us today.
Thank you.
Now we're going to transition to our third artistic performance of the morning. It's my pleasure in a moment to bring Jay Fajeda to the stage. I will introduce him more fully when we bring all of the artists to the stage, but let me just say by way of preface, you're going to see a piece from his self-written one-man show, an excerpt from his self-written one-man show, Cops and Robbers. And in this piece, Jay really seeks to use the arts as a means to really stimulate dialogue and discussion between communities that don't often speak to one another. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jay Fajeda.
Village from which I descend, a boy could not become a man just because he had his birthday. In the village from which I descend, honor was buried deeply within the breasts of men, like a treasure. And if you cannot look into the past, then you will never find it.
At home, Master! At home! Say all at once is my daughter! She's 13, Master. She's too young to be entertaining your friends. Master told me, mind my business. You hear that? My own daughter ain't my business. Well, I cut Master's throat. Now they say they're gonna burn me alive.
Well, it's already in hell.
We're standing here in front of the old Oakland auto plant. What was once a source of employment for many Oakland residents is now a crime scene. Witnesses say that an Oakland police officer shot a man across the street from this plant. The man then returned fire, wounding the officer, and managed to escape into the plant. Witnesses then say that the officer gave chase, and neither the man nor the officer have emerged from the plant since.
Now, what we have here is a blatant example of police terrorism at its worst. You see, instead of serving and protecting, they are murdering and neglecting those that they should be most obligated to serve and protect. Okay. You know, you leave it up to these people. And the thug will always be innocent, and the cop will always be guilty. I mean, you're talking about a people that spend more time and energy trying to take down a flag of heritage in American history. Has nothing to do with race, heritage, and history. Read a book. They spend more time and energy trying to take down that flag than they do raising their own children. And that, my people, that's how we end up here today. Sir! Indeed, sir. I'm all over it, sir. Johnson, Taylor, you get your asses in here. What in the hell's his problem? He's going after a barricaded suspect. Shot. Alone. He's freaking wounded. You know, this kid is so far outside of policy, I can't reach him this time. I want everything on that goddamn suspect. He's gotta be on parole, probation, all his priors. He shot a fucking cop. He didn't just start his career today. Huh? And I wouldn't give a damn if all he did was steal a bag of chips. I want it, I wanna write it up, and I wanna get it to that bitch journalist immediately. She's killing us out there. And Taylor, make sure she knows about all the community policing we're doing around here. Soccer programs and baseball and shit.
going back to jail. So I grew up in jail. I was born with an umbilical cord wrapped around my wrist and fluid in my lungs, so I couldn't say shit. They should have just let me die. What kind of sick motherfucker saves a life just to kill it 1,000 times? My mama's mama was my mama. And her daughter, she was just Tamika. And my father was everybody and nobody. Top ramen and matzo meal. Shit, now ladies, I can't sit still. My mama say I'm special, and that's why I was in special education. Teacher taught me how to get in line and shut up. Shit, that's how I knew I didn't need school, because I already knew how to get in the welfare line and shut up when the police talking to me. Yeah, I got hatred walking through me, bubbling to the surface, dripping from my lips like vomited venom. This is the vernacular of a virgin who has never known love, but fucks the world every day in every way. Marie, you stupid to pull a gun on me. You got 2 rounds in you, point blank range. You come out soon, you can bleed to death. Well, Mario, you rather die than go back to the pen? At least in the pen, you got options, right?
Bring the plenary to its final stage, and let me just remind us where we've been thus far this morning. We had the opportunity to hear from Donna Brazile this morning, who I think really powerfully and authentically spoke to the urgency of this moment, and I think really encouraged all of us to think about our role in addressing the political environment that we find ourselves in today. Then we had an opportunity to hear from Jane Chu, who spoke with us about the ways in which the arts can really connect with other disciplines to advance the issues that we care so deeply about in our society, and of course then joined in conversation with Bob Lynch to expand on some of those themes. And throughout, we've had the opportunity to see the work of 3 tremendous artists. And at this time, we think it's appropriate and fitting to close this plenary with a conversation with those artists. Artists who are helping to shape public dialogue, who are really helping us to address difficult and complicated problems in our society, and are really using their art to create change. So please join me in welcoming our 3 artists to the stage. So I know you have biographies, but let me just briefly do introductions that will not do justice to these 3 tremendous individuals. Immediately to my left is Vijay Gupta, who is a first violinist for the Los Angeles Philharmonic. But in addition to that, he's the co-founder of an organization that just celebrated its 5th anniversary called Street Symphony. And Street Symphony really brings together distinguished artists with opportunities to engage with some of our most marginalized citizens, often homeless, often incarcerated. And Vijay has been committed to that work at the same time as he's really pursued a very active artistic career. Next to him is Ana Teresa Fernandez, whose work you saw beautifully displayed on screen earlier today. As you know, she is a visual and conceptual artist whose work often confronts very difficult issues of sexism, of racial discrimination, and of social conflict. Her work includes videography, performance art, large-scale oil paintings, and then pieces that you saw like earlier today, again, Borrando la Frontera, or Erasing the Border, which we'll talk about in our conversation today. And finally, on the far right, the person whose performance we had the ability to just experience, Jay Fajeda, who spends his time as a sheriff's deputy in the Alameda County Sheriff's Office, and is also a rapper, and as you just saw a few moments ago, an actor. And Jay spends much of his time in the crime prevention unit of the Alameda Office Sheriff's Office, engaging with young people across the East Bay in California on issues of race and justice and the different paths available to them in life. The work that you just saw performed is something that was obviously inspired and was also done in part under the mentorship of Anna Deavere Smith, whom many of us know for the work that she has done over many, many years. So I want to start today by quoting something from Vijay's biography. He talks about, quote, the dedicated presence of citizen artists in civic discourse. So I want to ask each of you to talk a little bit. What does it mean to be a citizen artist to you?
I don't think I should go first.
It's ladies first.
Well, I think that comes up in discussion quite frequently. And for me, I think I like to participate as an active citizen by kind of creating a sense of awareness and resensitizing people to their intuition. I think for so long I was brought up in a system of education which was right and wrong, and I've often found myself as quite mediocre student. And you know, being ripped away from the country where I grew up in at 10 years old, the way that I dealt with that heartbreak was to continuously re-sculpt the memories, you know, the taste of my town, what those embraces felt like, the familiarity of tastes. And I think that that's coming back to myself and being aware of, you know, what I was feeling and not being desensitized from what I was told that was right and wrong, but trying to recreate what I felt was familiar. I think that that became what gave me agency, because that made me learn to really see and hear the communities in which I was working with or approaching or being invited to participate with, kind of really listening to their stories. And from that, just kind of internalizing and digesting it and being able to kind of put a mirror up to that community and being able to give them that sense of agency, because I think that so often society tells you that you have no agency, that you have to become accustomed to a set of behaviors. And I think that to be able to awaken that sense of imagination is so key, and to kind of make people really taste the climate and the temperature of their own feelings and become in tune with that intuition again.
DJ?
So I'm very lucky to be a classically trained violinist, which means that I, alongside every one of my colleagues, has spent 10,000 hours alone in a practice room before even thinking about auditioning for undergraduate level conservatory training. And then another additional 10,000 hours before we can even think about stepping foot on a stage to take an audition for an orchestra. So that doesn't really lend to very good people skills. You know, there's an amazing cellist who's a hero in our world named Pablo Casals. And Casals said, we are human beings first, we are musicians second, and he was a cellist, we are cellists third. And I think that the model of conservatory training emphasizes that we have to be perfect, beyond perfect, in the craft and in the technique of what we present to our audiences. And yet we are disconnected from the very reasons of why we should make art in the first place. We have this view of composers like Johann Sebastian Bach of being these very foreboding deconstructed, unconnected characters. And yet, if you look at the lives of composers like Bach or Beethoven or Mozart, they were not writing music to exist 300 years later. They were writing music for their communities during their time. Bach spent most of his time writing out budgets because he was looking for the number of players he would have available to him, usually amateur musicians, musicians who loved what they did, to be available to play the cantatas. And then based on who he had available, he'd write a cantata. And most of those cantatas don't exist today because it wasn't part of his world to preserve them 300 years later. He was writing for then and now. And just to mirror what Ana Teresa just said, it's our role as artists to hold up a mirror to our communities. But I would also say for us, trained in classical forms, to hold a mirror up to our own humanity, to find the very reasons why we ever chose to make art in the first place, that our art is not just a commodity. Our art is not just to be there on a stage to be sold, but that our art gives us a platform in the world to speak truth to power. And that music allows us to speak where words fail because music is not bound by words. So we can speak to the heart of what's happening in our world and in our own hearts.
Lovely.
I believe it just means being as informed as possible on multiple perspectives because art is powerful and it has the ability to take things that are complex and make them simple and communicate them from the soul, so it's gonna be strong. And if the artist is good, you're gonna reach people's spirits. So I just try to be as informed as possible and as knowledgeable as possible because I don't wanna communicate the wrong thing and lead people in the wrong direction.
Ana Teresa, we had a chance to see your work earlier, and much of your work, including the piece that we saw, really deals with these themes of exposure and erasure, kind of simultaneously. Tell us a little bit about how you landed on that theme, how that theme has evolved for you over time.
Yeah, in 2011, I went down to the Tijuana-San Diego border, and as you saw in the video, Borrando la Frontera, I scaled up a 15-foot ladder and began erasing the border. But I remember at the time that there was so much, this is a place I've known for about 6 years, and I had been doing actions and performances, and I felt like there was this polarizing discussion. There was, you know, people that wanted the wall and people that wanted to take it down, and it felt like it was ping-ponging back and forth consistently. And I just, there's a moment where, like I said, when I got in that sense of liberation without that border. So kind of in the midst of that discussion, I kind of filtered my way through, and one day just went down there with my mom and began doing this process. And all of a sudden, people from the community, from Playas de Tijuana, which are people that live around there, which get tired also of like the activism and the yelling and the loudspeakers, it was more like a whisper. And they told me, they came up to me and they were like, wow, I had actually never paid attention to the wall. We become so used to it. They become desensitized. And I'm reminded of what this space would look like without prison bars. And for me, it's using that, the sky blue, it kind of hits a note where you stop defining something and the blurriness opens up possibility. And I think when we kind of wake up in the morning and everything's slightly blurry, it asks us to bring ourselves to something. It asks us to participate, to become an active participant, to have a perspective, to become awakened to different parts of ourselves that make us uncomfortable, because definitions so often are what makes us comfortable. Oh, we understand that, we understand that. But when we don't, I think, you know, that's the scary part. And I think oftentimes if I'm not scared of what I'm doing, I feel like there's something wrong because I'm not pushing myself enough, you know? And I think that's the strength to inhabit spaces in which we don't really know, and we can grow within those spaces. We're allowed to become other things.
Thank you. In a moment, I'll invite you to bring your questions forward. There are, again, two microphones there in front, so please come up and we'll turn to your questions in a moment. I want to ask Vijay and Jay directly, and Ana Teresa should feel free to also chime in, but Vijay and Jay, one of the things that's interesting just looking at your bios, I think on a very superficial level, one might say you kind of lead double lives. I think about Vijay performing for the Los Angeles Philharmonic and at the same time working with D. deeply marginalized individuals in the streets of Los Angeles. And obviously, Jay, your work as a rapper, as an activist, and then combined with now being a sheriff's deputy. So can you guys talk a little bit about how that balance works?
Okay, well, I would have to drop activist from my title because, you know, I just out of respect because activists, I know they just devote 100% of themselves, you know, to whatever cause they're involved in. And like you said, I got multiple things going on. For me, I was in, you know, I have a band, you know, we toured the world for years and it was great. And we were from the Bay Area. We had like a political slant to our music and we're talking about what's going on in Oakland, you know, but we're in India. And the police in Oakland aren't listening to what we're saying. The people on the streets in Oakland aren't, they don't even know we exist. And you know, we're touring Europe and with the biggest artists in the world and we're making money and it's fun. But there was something missing. And as it started to slow down, it was around the time, it was 2009, January 1st, a man by the name of Oscar Grant got killed at the Fruitvale BART station by the BART police. And you know, we were out there. I have a degree in black studies, me and all my classmates, we were past classmates, we were out there and artist community was, if not hundreds, if not thousands of people there. And we all want justice. And you know, in talking to people, you know, the theme was we want to get rid of the bad cops because we knew that the cops existed that didn't necessarily have the same values that we did in the community. And they had authority and power over us to a certain degree. And everyone wanted to get rid of the bad cops, the ones that were maybe racist or heavy-handed or, you know, overly aggressive, trigger-happy. And we wanted to get rid of them. But just being there in that environment with all that passion, I started to think, you know, we just want this dude indicted. What if we could magically identify all of the bad cops in the country and get rid of them? Who would replace them? You know? Because I knew I wouldn't. And I knew none of my friends would. And I looked around at the people, the faces of the people that were there that were passionate and full of love. And I couldn't imagine any of them stepping up to replace them. And I felt like I had been getting caught up in this feeling of, you know, we'll get rid of the bad cops and then it'll be good policing, or we're gonna crush the police departments themselves. And, you know, just these things that, like, I couldn't foresee happening for hundreds of years, if not ever, right? And when I couldn't answer who would replace them, all different races there, nationalities, ages, you know, if no one had thought like us would be willing to replace that bad cop, it's an incredibly high probability that someone that thinks like the bad cop would replace him. So in the best case scenario of getting rid of all the bad cops in the country, we would be right back at the protest a year from then. And that was just a hard thing to deal with. And I continued in the arts world for about a year after that. And I met a friend who told me I could actually pay my way through the police academy because I didn't think they would ever hire me. I grew up in Oakland during the crack epidemic. I got friends that are in prison, that are dead. You know, I've been arrested before. So I said, okay, well, I'll pay my way through. If they kick me out, at least I did what I was supposed to do, you know? And I end up giving a commencement speech at the graduation. So I've been in there for about 5 years, but about a year in, traveling back and forth between my community and the job and the coworkers and my professors and my mother, who's my first teacher, and the little kids that I used to counsel in juvenile hall who were now in jail. You know, all of that stuff, I felt like I was on overload and I had to do something. I knew it couldn't be a song because I couldn't communicate how I felt in 4 minutes. So this is my first play. And I wrote it and acted in it. And it says what I wanted to. It's a lot of pain in it. Thank you. Thank you. But that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
I actually forgot.
BJ.
So I actually want to bring up the story of someone who's becoming a mentor of mine. I'm very honored and lucky to have just joined the board of directors of Americans for the Arts. And I started reading the work of another fellow board member named Liz Lerman, and her book is actually out here. Her book is called Hiking the Horizontal, and it should sell out in the next, you know, 15 minutes. It's on Kindle as well. And I actually heard about Liz's work and I guessed her email. So I read the introduction of her book, which is like this manifesto on bringing dance specifically into what at the time was senior centers. But Liz has danced for CERN. Liz has danced for the Department of Defense. She is one of the great models of art infusion in community. And so I read her bio and I thought, well, this woman is very straightforward. Her email is either info@lizlerman.com or liz@lizlerman.com. And I got an email back the next morning from liz@lizlerman.com. And she spent two hours of her time on the phone with me. Wow. And it was just this mark of incredible generosity from artists that I think artists experience within our own communities. And likewise, just as an aside, such a deep gratitude from us artists to be able to hold this stage alongside everyone here. A huge debt of gratitude to Americans for the Arts for having us here. We're so grateful. And one of the things that Liz talks about is that it's not that the concert hall is here and the senior center is here. Nor is it that the jail or the homeless shelter where we take music in to perform for disenfranchised communities is here and the concert hall is here. It's that they operate on a horizontal plane. And that the work and the art that we create in the concert hall feeds the work and art that we bring into the jail. And likewise, the presence of bringing art into the jail feeds how we play in the concert hall. And so I actually don't see a dichotomy here. I see an approach to authenticity and wholeness. One of the things that I've begun to find is that in the work of Street Symphony, in the nearly 200 performances we've conducted in the Skid Row community in Los Angeles over the last 5 years, the people who are most transformed by the work we do are the artists themselves, right? We find our own grounding, we find our own meaning, and we find that we have a welcome voice within a community of ostracized people that then we can bring into the communities of privilege that we also have access to. One of the most beautiful things I feel that I take with me from seeing Jay's work and Ana Teresa's work is that there's this element of provocation. And I think that part of our role as artists is to be masterful provokers and to be disruptors, but to also have the grace and charm and art to bring those who we've disrupted into the conversation and to injure and heal at the same time.
So well put. Beautiful, Vita. Again, invite people, if they have questions, to come up to the mic. You, a moment ago, paid tribute to Americans for the Arts for inviting you as artists to be part of this conversation. I will note, and I'm sure many of you have sat through many, many plenaries at many, many conferences, this is perhaps one of the first, and with no offense to you, Bob Lynch, this is perhaps one of the first where everyone, practically, except for Bob, has been a person of color, is a person of color. And I think that speaks to the remarkable commitment to diversity, but not just in the sense of let's fill slots, but in the sense of let's get the very best people that we can to have an interesting conversation about these issues. So kudos to you. So staying on that theme, as artists of color, do you sometimes feel a particular weight or a particular sensibility in your work that you have to represent certain audiences, that you have to engage in a particular kind of way? You all think about this theme, and I'm wondering how that comes into your art.
No, I know it comes into my art. It comes into, you know, the way I go about doing the job too. And it makes things, there's definitely more pressure around everything when you're seeing the whole picture as opposed to just looking at a small piece of it. You know, in law enforcement, you can be highly rewarded for focusing on a small piece of what it has been determined by society that your job is. And you could just do that and you'll get promoted and you'll be worshipped at the department. But if you don't look outside of that, then you run the dangers of, you know, enforcing something that's very wrong and enforcing a system of oppression that disenfranchises people, basically. So I take it with me everywhere. In the art, when I first got qualified to work the streets, I said, I'm gonna knock on every door in this community and I'm gonna meet people. And the next day, an email went out to everyone on patrol that a black male in his 30s had stolen a uniform and was impersonating a cop. So,
no,
really. Wow. And that was the day when I stopped telling youngsters to pull their pants up. You know, because if I'm in a police uniform and I get the police called on me, then, you know, what kind of ground do I have to stand on to tell you to pull your pants up because things may be worse for you, right? So just understanding all different perspectives and being a person, being a black man, and going out into the world every day, I could, there are a number of different things I could do. I could be extremely angry and attack. I can just forget about it and try to assimilate, or I could do the very hard work of trying to make sure some suitable form of communication happens where people at least know where other people are coming from and they're not communicating to each other by that news lady, you know, or this guy in the chair.
Well, I think I'm deeply affected of the way in which I was brought up, you know, having a bicultural, binational upbringing. But I was also deeply obsessed with communications and languages. And so I thought I was going to be a linguist. I was on my way to my fifth language when I got picked up by the Art Institute and given a scholarship. And because I realized very quickly that art is so much more expansive. You know, you're not relying on adjectives and adverbs, and it becomes so open. And I think that you're able to translate and communicate much more broadly. And this idea of, I think, communication and languages, you know, I can't divorce myself from how people actually, you know, you think of slang and the beautiful ways in which people express themselves in very, very small, you know, the folkloric ways in which people express themselves, like so-and-so doesn't have hair on their tongue, no tiene pelos en la lengua, like they got no filter. So I think that using kind of those visuals for me from the places that I've traveled and lived and worked with a variety of communities in South Africa and Haiti and Spain and Mexico, whatnot. For me, it's like learning to kind of embrace that folklore, learning to kind of see people for how they want to be seen and kind of being able to sing along with them, you know, and help create that agency. Because I think ultimately, I think what that does creatively is what Angela Glover Blackwell said. She coined this term. She's a public health humanist. And she coined this term collateral benefits. When she was 5 years old, she looked up and she saw these, you know, birds and on the telephone lines. And she's like, Mom, the bird benches. She's like, and her mom was like, no, those are telephone lines. And so this idea that this one thing can be used for multiple things, and hence the sidewalks, the dips on the sidewalks that were invented for handicaps, but then rollerbladers and moms. I think that collateral benefit can be, you know, arts can birth a lot of collateral benefits, and it actually can affect policy, and it can affect how we see and experience each other, and awaken our imagination to be able to have more acceptance and be able to dialogue with each other.
So the diversity that's demonstrated on this stage is remarkable. And yet I believe that the systems in which we operate, the audiences that I play for, the music I play, the people who fund the organization that I'm lucky enough to be part of, the LA Philharmonic, are mostly white men. And so we can demonstrate diversity by putting it on stages, but I think that part of the next journey is to create and craft organizations from the top down that look like the communities we wish to serve. I am very lucky to be led by Gustavo Dudamel in the Los Angeles Philharmonic. And with Gustavo's advent to the United States there's been this amazing El Sistema program that has swept the entire United States. And it is a remarkable program. It is a remarkable program. And there are kids all over the country who come from poor neighborhoods who are now able to make music in a way that they would never have been able to otherwise. However, at what point is it cultural colonialism for us to take the music of amazing geniuses but dead white men into communities of color? What does Beethoven mean, truly, to a community from Compton? Does it truly have meaning? Does it only have meaning because in that way those kids from Compton then have relevance to come and perform at Walt Disney Concert Hall? And this is a vulnerable, difficult, painful question. And I think we have to lean into this vulnerability. One of the things that we've begun to see happen in my organization, in Street Symphony, is we were very lucky to bring a sing-along performance of Handel's Messiah to the Midnight Mission, one of the largest Skid Row homeless shelters. And our musicians, who were members of the LA Philharmonic and LA Master Chorale, members of Street Symphony, brought in workshops to teach folks in Skid Row to sing the Messiah along with us. And so we had, you know, the greatest hits, the Hallelujah Chorus, Glory to God, the great, amazing works from the Messiah, and had everyone in the audience singing. And at the ends of rehearsals, the folks we were training in Skid Row started singing gospel songs back to us. We had women in the Compton jail in Linwood hear our performance of Schumann and Beethoven and then say, "Can we sing for you?" So I feel that part of the job and part of the platform is for us as artists to create a space where there would otherwise never be a space, and then to step back and allow people to come into that space and to hold them and to give them value and the same platform that we're lucky enough to hold ourselves.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
I'm a little worried that Donna scared people from asking questions earlier this morning, but please, if you have questions, do come up to the podium. Here we have somebody coming up on the left-hand side. Nope. Oh, sorry.
It's on. Good morning.
Why don't we go here first, and then we'll go over there.
Thank you all for your presentation this morning. This isn't really a question, it's a comment. The question that you asked the panelists about how they, the role of being artists of color and the burden, I just want to let you inform you that that is a very challenging and insulting question, in the sense of that is an issue that artists of color have always been faced with, and you would, I don't think that you would ask that question about representing people if they were white artists on stage. So I just need to tell you that that is, I found that particularly difficult, and I just needed to educate you.
I appreciate that comment. Thank you very much. Yes.
And I want to make a comment too that I hope isn't going into untoward territory, but I just want to make a comment about you describing George as an activist, and he demurred and said he didn't consider himself an activist. But I cannot imagine a better example of an activist than a person who literally becomes the thing that they think needs to be in society. So, very well done.
Thank you. Yes, over here.
My question is for Mr. Ferreira. The suspect spoke a lot of women. Started with my daughter, with the man in the handcuffs, and then later on, practically dying words were his grandmother and his mother. And I'm curious, how do women play such an important role? And secondly, do women have a special role in youth development?
Okay, those are two different characters.
Right, I knew, yeah.
Forgive me if I didn't communicate that well enough. But yes, of course.
No, I got that, yeah.
You said, how do women play a role in what?
Do women play a special role in youth development, in developing a child's morals, integrity? Because the man was dying, and he still called for his grandmother and his mother.
Yeah, I believe everyone plays a role in youth development. But in this particular case, this this guy over here that was dying was a product of the crack epidemic. And, you know, during the crack epidemic, a lot of children were raised by their grandmothers because the men and the women were, in large, wiped out of the community. A lot of jobs had left the community and went overseas in the late 70s and early 80s. Crack hit in the early 80s, mid 80s. Men were out of work. They found a way to make $1,000 a day selling crack and even more. And a lot of the women were hooked on it. So a lot of people died and went to prison. So he was speaking from that context, being raised by his grandmother.
Please.
Oh, sorry. Yes, good morning to the artists, and I congratulate everybody for the performance. It was excellent and touched my soul. My question is mostly like to this morning, Mr. Let me see, the President of NIA, Jen Chu, she mentioned the importance of not just organizations into the art, but I'm concerned about the art in education. I've seen in from even elementary schools to college how the government and the organizations short, are very short, or they cut the resources for arts and humanities into the pensum. So you, as an artist, how you see more difficulty or more easier to continue your careers as a performer or artist if in the education is the audience, the community is lack of education of the formal education because no resources. So how you see the job is more easy for you if the community is not informed or educated, or you think you are lost the time to fight against the situation?
Yeah, so I from what I understood, sir, from your question, is it more difficult for us as performers and artists now in a context where there's not a more formal arts education in our communities at large? And I think that, yes, there is a greater challenge for us as performers, but there's also a call to action for us as performers and artists to find more definitions of ourselves and to really break all the walls we can to approach our audiences on their terms, regardless of their level of education. I think that we, in a sense, have to even redefine what education means. That part of the biggest part of the work is showing up. It's in not creating barriers to say, well, you're not good enough or informed enough or educated enough to come to my concert hall. I don't think that model works anymore.
Yeah, I think it's, I had a terrible experience with arts and education. I had none growing up. The first time I actually took an art class, I was 18 years old. And so for me, to have not been allowed to think or experience life through that way, I think it's such a tragedy. And I think that's something that I really worked and strive towards in my own practice. You know, I teach at a university level, but I am always constantly seeking out ways in which, even if high schools or middle schools don't have an arts program, how can we infiltrate creating after-school programs, or when I travel abroad, it's when communities come home, just showing up and holding a space where you just have paint, and they're able to access that and create that agency in which it becomes something, it becomes a medium in which they can express themselves, but also they understand that that's a possibility. And I think that there's possibility disparity, especially where I grew up in Mexico. Like, I never thought I could be an artist. I never was granted the process of thinking that I could have access to that. And I think that possibility disparity is so discouraging. Like, we need to create a system that, you know, a ministry of culture of sorts that allows for youth to be able to think not in right and wrong, but think for themselves, have a perspective, have a feeling, have a thought that's not 2 + 2 = 4, but what does it feel? How does this awaken something in you? And I think that is so imperative. And so often when I ask a kid what they feel, they say, I don't know. You know, I don't know is so frequent the answer. And I wish that there was more literacy for people to be able to actually, to, you know, become literate of their emotions. And I think the arts grants that. It makes us internalize what we're feeling, our psychology, and I think it's so important.
Thank you. And as we wrap up, I'm going to start with you, Jay, and then just work down the panel. Let me give each of you sort of a final comment, a minute for any final observation. We started the morning really, I think, with Donna really exhorting us to seize this moment and be engaged. Are there any exhortations or any final words of advice that you have for all of us? Jay.
Yeah, art lives in the heart and the soul. We didn't have art programs growing up, but I grew up in hip hop, and if you wanted to paint something, you just grabbed a spray can and you painted it on the side of a wall, or you know, hip hop and break dancing. And I believe that some forms of art are supposed to exist outside of institutions, but institutions also have to be impacted by art. I don't believe institutions are built to change. I believe they have to be forced to change, and we need more artists inside of the institutions, but the art that they create cannot be controlled by the institution, or else it's not gonna work. It's gonna be neutered. So, you know, artists and social justice activists have infiltrated education. When my mother was in elementary school, they were taught that Egypt wasn't a part of Africa. You know, arts and social justice activists have infiltrated education, politics, everywhere except for law enforcement, the military, and I'm waiting on that because it's in desperate need of it, and we're not gonna see what we want until that happens.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think that arts is a form and way in which we can create and sensitize ourselves to our intuition. And I think it allows us to discover things and invent a language in which we're able to communicate ourselves and communicate our communities to the rest of the world.
I'm thinking of something that my friend and mentor Bob Lynch said when he was up here with Jane Chu in talking about indigenous and Native American communities, that there is no life without art. They are not defined, they're not distinctions. Art is part of life, and there's a story of the Maasai tribe that comes to mind, that the Maasai people wander the plains with no food storage. They only eat what they hunt or gather in that one day. And spontaneously on the plains of the Sahara, the Maasai people will gather together and they will jump and they will sing and they will dance and they will shout and they will clap and they will create these spontaneous bursts of energy. And they don't do it because they've gathered together to say, now let's make some art. They do it to stay present. They do it to stay present for the lion that is stalking them. Because if one person doesn't see the lion, the entire tribe, the entire gathering of people is at risk. And to echo what Donna Brazile said this morning, the lions are coming. I can only imagine that a prospective horrifying Trump presidency would allow you to have the most unbelievable canvas across the Mexico-American border. And let's do everything to prevent that wall from being built, but let's make as many beautiful interruptions, as many gorgeous shouts as we possibly can, so that we can change our world.
Yeah.
Well, we have had a full morning, to say the least, and let me just conclude by making this observation. If you think about the span of topics that we covered this morning, I somehow keep coming back to two terms that I think kept sort of presenting in each of the conversations, and those two concepts are of agency and of integrity. And when I say integrity, by the way, I mean sort of the more kind of full definition of that word, which is about wholeness, not just operating with integrity. And if you think about what Donna spoke to us this morning and really the importance of exercising our agency in this political moment, what Jane and Bob talked about in the importance of looking at the arts in a broader whole with much more integrity connected to many other disciplines and efforts that are taking place, and then finally this terrific, inspiring panel where we have artists who are operating with integrity and also through their art encouraging our agency in their work. So with that, will you please join me in thanking them and all of you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome.
I don't know about you, I'm just so glad that this is being taped because there was some powerful wisdom on this stage just now. So it's my job right now to make sure that you know about all the wonderful opportunities that are in store for you this afternoon and this evening. I'm going to set you up with all the logistics that you need to get through the rest of your day. But first, I do really want to thank the keynote speakers again, Donna Brazile, Jane Chu, Bob Lynch, Ana Teresa Fernandez, Jay Ferreira, and our co-board member, Vijay Gupta. And I want to give a special thank you to Jim Canales for being our guide through this wonderful journey this morning. Thank you so much. Let's give everybody another round of applause. But I also want to give a big thanks to all of you for attending the Americans for the Arts annual convention. We really, really appreciate, and on behalf of myself and my co-board members, we appreciate you making the commitment of your time and your resources to be here today, and as Donna Brazile told us, to be involved. So give yourselves a round of applause as well. Okay, so now the reminders for the rest of your day. Immediately following this plenary, we're going to usher you to the other side of the ballroom, outside the ballroom, to the hall for a buffet lunch. There's not a single minute of programming during this lunch. It's just a time for you to network, to think, to get back to your room, to catch up on the work you're missing, to catch up with friends. Those of you who are attending the Art Venture need to be journeyed down to the lobby at the hotel 1:15 p.m. The tours will leave at 1:30. And if you're interested in attending an art venture, but you haven't yet registered, you can visit the main registration desk to see what's available. If you aren't taking an art venture, do not fear. We've got three sets of really fantastic breakouts for you, plus a set of roundtables. All this programming begins, again, with a breakout starting at 1:15 p.m. And then finally, after today's programming is done, and you've returned from your arts ventures, we've got two fantastic and fun events for you this evening. Starting at 6 p.m., you're all invited to attend the outdoor patio on level 5 for the Meet the Members reception. It's a great opportunity to meet and mingle, and you do not have to be a member to come on down. Directly following, we are going to be right back here in the Grand Ballroom for a special immersive concert experience called Inclusive by Design. This free blues concert, which will be employing principles of universal design to create a multi-sensory, multi-art, accessible experience, is presented to celebrate and honor the 25 years of the Americans for the Disabilities Act by VSA Massachusetts, an affiliate of Seven Hills Foundation and part of the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts International VSA affiliate network. Let me tell you a little bit about this in a preview. It sounds so cool. A visual artist will interpret the music by creating a very large mural live on stage, and all the work will be accompanied by audio description, American Sign Language interpretation, and live captioning. The end result is that it's going to allow an experience for people of all abilities, including those who may be deaf, who may be hard of hearing, who may be blind, who may have low vision, to be fully engaged in a shared creative experience. Come check it out tonight at 7 p.m. right here again in this ballroom. It's an experience that you will not want to miss. So thank you all again. Enjoy Boston, enjoy the rest of the convention, and let's go eat.